Good afternoon, everyone. Can I have a good afternoon back? I knew you all will be feeling a bit sleepy because we just had lunch. So kindly bear with me on this. So welcome to DrupalCon Vienna. And I'm Jyoti Singh. I'm working in Shrijan Technologies as a Drupal developer. And I'm really very excited for this DrupalCon because that's my first DrupalCon as a speaker. And I've been in this beautiful city, Vienna, and with a lot of beautiful people out here. So moving on, I'll just give us a short description of what topics we are going to have in our sessions today. What is BigPipe? How does BigPipe actually works? How to use BigPipes in our current project? Implementation of some BigPipe modules in our Drupal 8 sites, and a demo of BigPipes along with some few illustrations. It's a really short demo. So who all out here have worked on BigPipe? Okay, not so many. And how about Drupal 8? Oh, lot many of people. So the BigPipe is being introduced in Drupal 8, so it's not a concept of Drupal 7. So it's a new introduction in Drupal 8 right now. The topic for today's session is tunneling its way fast with BigPipe. So today we'll be talking about BigPipe. And I'm Jyoti Singh with a hashtag @jyoti.singh in Twitter. So before starting my session, I would like to give a word of thanks to Wim Leers and Fabian Franz, who've done a fantastic job for giving us big pipes and caching for Drupal 8. So it's said that Drupal 8 is one of the fastest ever Drupal. So that's because of Wim Leers and Fabian Franz that we have a fantastic caching system in Drupal 8 and big pipes. So what do you want when you browse a site? So what type of site does you guys usually browse into? Anyone from the crowd? Can I have answer from you, sir?
Facebook.
So what happens when it loads really slow? What do you think?
Something's broken,
right? And it's like you just close the page or you just refresh the page again?
Both,
yeah. So it takes your time and maybe you get frustrated sometime. Yeah. So why should the user be concerned about the page load time? It should be like he should be on the website and it should load fast. That was the user one. He nothing wants to see anything technical into the site. He doesn't want to sleep when he goes to the site. So how does the user feel? It's like how does I feel when I do the shopping? It's like sometimes it's really slow. The page is really slow and I'm sleepy too. So what's the importance of the time? So I went through some of the stats. It's completely the stats that I found on Google. So it says that 40% of users abandon their site if it takes more than 3 seconds to load it. So it's totally impacting the business, right? So if I say I have a business and my site is running and the user is not satisfied at all, then there's something going wrong in my site. So it's like 79% of the shoppers who are dissatisfied with the website never ever go to the site again. So that's again impacting my business. And there are also many other domains that get affected by the same things. That's like say search engine. Because if your site is slow, sometimes Google just doesn't get to read the keywords that you have in your pages. So if I ask a question that how fast you think that your site should load, so what answer would you have in your mind? Some answers?
As fast as possible.
1 millisecond? 300 millisecond. Okay. So there was a survey done by Akamai and Gomez.com, and they found that nearly more than half of the user on the website want their page to load in less than 2 seconds. And that's gradually decreasing every time because we are becoming more digitalized and we want our pages to get loaded as fast as possible. So when I say fast, what does fast means? So there are a few measurements that I have here with respect to what fast means when I go or browse a page. It's a great user experience. When I hit the page, I should see the site. Then it's time to first byte. What's time to first byte? It's the response that you get from your web server. So it should be as fast as possible to make your site load fast. Then it's time to asset fetching. How fast your JavaScript, your CSS, your images are being fetched in your site. That's also a very key point in your optimization and performance measurement for your site. And then there's a new term that's time to interaction that gave a path to big pipes and other things that are being introduced nowadays in our site. So what does time to interact means is the first interaction that the user has with your site. So the whenever you load your site, at least you should have some content that the user is to keep the user intact to your site. And lastly, the page load time, of course, should be minimal for the user. There are some other usual optimization that we usually do in our site. That is optimizing our code, making the query as simple as possible, and using caching and other things. And if I say from the front-end perspective, it is we minify JS, we minify CSS, we try to reduce images, we try to cache images, and we try to make as small and as low connections as possible. So how can we make the page load faster? Even with such optimizations that I already discussed, we still have lag of time in our pages. Especially if I talk about Drupal, I see that even after working on my optimization for CSS and JS, I still have the slow page load time in my site. So what Drupal 8 said was, cache everything. You should have correct invalidation in Drupal 8. So anybody who's worked with caching in Drupal 8? Great amount of people. So correct invalidation with your render API, specifically if I say render API, it would be, you should know where to put the cache tags, cache keywords. Cache contents, cache max age, and cache tags are specifically for your render API to make the page optimize. So when we use cache context, it's cache context dependent. So sometimes you want the page to display user specific content, or you want to display some cache content in your specific URL. So here where we use cache context. Secondly, cache max age is used for those content that usually change within some time period. Like for some blogs that we are fetching Twitter handles or some feeds from another third-party sites. And then cache tags are totally dependent on the data Drupal renders. So even after I put up the cache for everything, I have some problem. So further on, I'm going to discuss what problem I usually have with my site. We say cache all things. Does cache solve everything in Drupal 8? People say yes. Caching is the powerful weapon in Drupal 8. But somewhere it fails. It fails in cases where we have dynamic and static content in the same page. So handling static content with caching is very easy. It makes your page really, really very fast. Just in case of Drupal 8, we have anonymous page caching. So it's really powerful in Drupal 8. But when we talk about dynamic content that are really user-specific or that changes really very frequently, like for example, if we talk about some shopping site that's really user-specific and its content changes now and then with every user choices and the selections. So in that cases, the caching fails. How can you cache something that's really changing every now and then? So the answer is, how can we optimize the page that is very dynamic? What can be done for that? So what Drupal 8 provided with the solution is placeholders. So any idea about the placeholders? Anyone in the crowd? Ever heard about placeholders? Okay, so, sir, can you give me any idea about the placeholder?
Facebook does it.
Okay. Okay, that's the rendering, how Facebook renders the page. Like, it's render your static part first, and then it's render the dynamic page that's user-specific, correct? Okay. So placeholder is something I'm going to go into the technical details. What can we do with the dynamic content? What Drupal 8 actually does. I haven't started with big pipes yet. It's still the Drupal 8 core part that I'm talking about, the placeholders. So for the placeholders, the Drupal 8 core uses a single flush technologies that is used to handle the really very dynamic part of your page. For instance, if I say if I am in a shopping cart and I am changing my choices and I am deselecting and selecting some of the things, so what should I do then? So what Drupal core does is, it creates a DOM with static content, and then it creates a paste holder for every dynamic content. So you get the static content at the first time to first byte when you load the page, and then after it, the page is refreshed and the placeholder are replaced by your dynamic content. So what user get to see is something. Because what happens is, if you see that the page is loading and it's showing me nothing, then it's for no use for me as a user. So if you get to see something, then you are interacting with your site. So what Drupal 8 does is, it places all of your dynamic content in a placeholder, and it's a part of the render API. So render API creates a placeholder, and that is replaced by the dynamic part of your page. So this concept is really renowned concept when we talk about big pipes, is performance versus perceived performance. Performance is something you want to measure in terms of efficiency, time to first byte, and something that is quantitative. But when we talk about perceived performance, I cannot quantify it, because as a user, you may have some other perspective of your page loading. For me, I want to see some images when I load the page. You want to see some username, so that I cannot quantify the perceived performance for me. So as said by Dennis Michonneau, the psychological time in our brain usually differs from the objective time of the clock. That means what you perceive is really different from what it exactly is. So how long it takes to generate the page is what I can quantify. But how long it takes me to see the content is something that totally depends on each other's perception. So if I show you the stats of the Facebook performance, as said by Sir, that Facebook uses the big pipes. So Facebook uses big pipes, and it has drastically reduced the page load time to almost 50% by using it. So what is BigPipe? BigPipe was a concept conceived by Facebook. And what theory it works on is that whenever the user loads the page, it renders the static content of the page. And after that, loads the dynamic content in the DOM of the page. So this is what BigPipe actually works in really lame word. So BigPipe made Facebook as twice as fast. And it segregates the page into smaller chunks known as pagelets. I'll be discussing about the pagelet in the next slide. And BigPipe pipelines pagelet to several execution stages inside web server and browser. So I'll be covering this up when I'll be discussing the pagelets. So what pagelet is? Pagelet is a component of HTML page that contains layout, directives, code, HTML, everything of the page. And what BigPipe does is, it divides the page into different pagelets. And when you render the page in your browser, it first renders your static content and then slowly renders every pagelet. So here's a small demonstration between how the standard caching works and how the BigPipe caching is used to render the page. So here you can see in the standard way, it's loading all the DOM together. So the user is not able to see the content, any interactive content whenever he loads the site. But with BigPipes, what he sees is a header, something product, and some footer, and then some dynamic content with social media and some more products to be loaded in next phase. So what this helps the user is with interacting with your site more. So it takes the same time in the end, but the perceived performance is better. If you say BigPipe has been a really big achievement and it has made Drupal 8 really, really very fast, so I would say it has made the perceived performance very fast. If you have a really heavy content page with a really dynamic content, the time to first byte and the time to asset fetching would be really affected, but the overall page load won't be affected that much. So if you'll be using BigPipe and you say that my page would be really loaded fast, then I would say it would be incorrect to say. The perceived performance would be really fast, but not the actual load time. So here's a small difference between BigPipe and lazy load. So many people ask me that why not lazy load when we are using lazy load so much with JavaScript, with everything content in Drupal 8. We have so much to do with lazy load. Why to introduce BigPipe? So there are a few differences between the structure, costing, and the speed for both. So when we talk about structure, the Ajax request that lazy loading has is different from the one that BigPipe has. So for every scroll or for every Ajax hit, for your lazy load, we have different Ajax requests per HTML response. But for if I talk about BigPipe, what BigPipe does is it accumulates all your Ajax requests and posts it in one HTML response. So that's the difference. So structural difference I will be discussing when I'll be going into the detail as to how BigPipe works. And for the processing cost, it's almost the same for the lazy load and BigPipes. But for the speed, it's almost one-third the speed of lazy load. So BigPipe is really 3 times as faster as lazy load. So if I say if I have to use lazy load, in my Drupal site. So what people usually say is there is a tremendous amount of content you want to show in views listing page, and I want to implement a lazy load. So I would rather say that lazy loading is basically for images and not for content, though we still are using it for content management also. And for if I say about SEO purpose, so if I have a one-page application and I use a lazy load, then some of the content may not exist for Google. So that would be affecting the search optimization for your site. And every lazy load, I said, fires a HTTP request. So that we have really, we have many number of endpoints for lazy loads. But for BigPipes, we just have a single HTML response for every Ajax. So how BigPipe actually works in general, I'm going to show that first. And then we'll be moving on into the details for the BigPipes. So for the processing of the page by the BigPipes, there is a request parsing that uses the web server parses and sanity check for every HTTP request that you are going to request from your web browser. And then there'll be the data fetching from the web browser and stored in the architecture or the tier that you have for your site. And then there's a markup generation wherein the BigPipe would understand what static part and what dynamic part does your page has. And then there would be a network transport. The response is transferred from web server to your browser. Then we have a CSS downloading and the asset downloading by your page. Then there's a DOM tree construction and CSS styling that is associated, wherein we construct the DOM, but we do not add into the dynamic content. Then there is JavaScript downloading, wherein the JavaScript asset of your browser is being downloaded. And then there is JavaScript execution that for your site. So this is how BigPipe actually works in stages. So this is basically a theoretical thing that I wanted to add to the session. So how does BigPipe create placeholder? So we talked about how core create the placeholder, but how is BigPipe actually using those placeholder? So if I say I already have a placeholder in my Drupal 8 core, so what does BigPipe does? That's the concept is auto placeholdering. When we say placeholdering, it's creating a dynamic content every time, but you need to specify that which dynamic content are you going to have. But with BigPipes, what BigPipe does is it's automatically differentiate between the static and the dynamic content. So you need not explicitly specify for your comments, for the user comment, for your user specific block, for your changing content to be up to be included in the placeholder. It is automatically identified BigPipes. So there are the sections that have been replaced by the placeholder for the Drupal core, and in BigPipes, they are automatically identified and rendered. So Drupal can what Drupal actually at the end sends out is a markup along with your static content. And then after loading the DOM, it loads your dynamic content as a placeholder. So there the condition where for your content, browser content lies for auto placeholdering are high cardinality, wherein some content that have a lot of variation, as I talked about, like if you are fetching a Twitter feed from a third party, then it's really dynamic. And then the content which have a block that is constantly changing now and then is having a high invalidation rate. And also for those content that has a really small cache max age have high invalidation rate. So that falls into the category of differentiating by the BigPipes that what all content of your site are actually dynamic. So we talked about the single flush strategy that Drupal 8 uses in its core. But what BigPipe uses is an nflush strategy for the rendering API. So there's two categories wherein the BigPipe's render API works. First is a default placeholdering strategy, wherein I talked about that there are n AJAX responses for the BigPipe, but there would be just single HTML response every time, unlike lazy loading. So here's a code from BigPipe. So it's a file inside SRC folder, and this class has a create BigPipe placeholder function, wherein it creates the placeholder for your dynamic content. So what argument it takes actually is a original placeholder, then placeholder render API that you are going to use for your content. And then what it actually does is it creates a caching mechanism for those content, and it add up the markup for your static content. So here the placeholder are being created by the BigPipes. So I would just wanted to give a glance of how BigPipe module actually works towards it. Another strategy is a Node.js BigPipe placeholder strategy. Though BigPipe doesn't work with the JS when there is no JS and when there is no session, but still there is a technical terminology for Node.js big placeholder. So what it does, it combines all the embedded HTML responses into one HTML response. So how it looks in the code is, in the same file that I showed you before, there is another function that is create BigPipe Node.js placeholder, wherein you are not using the JS. I would rather say it is not part of the BigPipe concept, but still it's included in there. So what it does is it takes original placeholder, render array, and some attributes as the concept, as an argument, and then it creates the placeholder with nflush strategy. So earlier we didn't use the JS. Earlier we used the JS, and now we don't have the JS. So how did BigPipe successfully make your page load faster? So where it actually creates the pagelets and everything in its code. So here's another send content function in the same file. And what it actually does, it's used three functions, that's send pre-body, send placeholders, and send post-body. I've already marked their three functions. I hope it's visible to all. So send pre-body, it takes the HTML from your browser request, and then it finds out what is the static and the dynamic content. And then in the send placeholder, it sends all the dynamic content. And in the post body, it posts the static content for your browser. So what it usually do is it creates two sections of a static and dynamic page before rendering. So placeholdering, how Drupal core is different from BigPipe placeholdering. So I created a snapshot for the Drupal core, how the render array look for your page. So we have every request we make, the Drupal core creates a render API with markup, max age, caching tags, and BigPipe placeholder. And I guess this one is the Drupal 8 core render API, wherein it uses the lazy builder with, you cannot see any BigPipe variable or the array, render array. Here what you see is a lazy builder that is being used by Drupal 8 core. And we have the comment section, the comment render array. And then there's another lazy builder for the same comment. And this is the array that is being used by BigPipe, the render API array. And here it creates the markup for the static content that it renders first. And then it has all the cache tags like max age and context. And then it has a BigPipe placeholder, wherein you can see that there's another lazy builder for the same comment. So this is how BigPipe actually distinguish that what is the dynamic content in your page. So how do we use BigPipes in Drupal? That's really simple. That's a no configuration module. You need to just enable the module, and there is no configuration that is associated with this module. And it actually works with internal dynamic page, wherein with the help of internal dynamic page, it uses the static content to be rendered first before then the dynamic content. And for the internal page cache, it doesn't actually affect the internal page cache because it works only for the sessions of the user. I'm going to show you a quick demo for the BigPipe. Here's a demo site, wherein I have a list of many contents with a lot of content and images. And there is a block at left-hand side that shows me the Twitter field, the latest Twitter field with the Drupal tag. So it is the dynamic content here. And right now, I don't have the BigPipe module enabled for this site. So if I try to time needed for time to first byte here. Is it visible to everyone, the time to first byte? So it's 1.32 seconds, the time to first byte. Now I'm going to enable the module. The module is enabled. And you can see the drastic change in the time to first byte. It's like 55.75 milliseconds. So even with having the long list of my page and with a dynamic block, I'm able to achieve the time a smaller number of time to first byte here. So this is how BigPipe works. I didn't have any configuration. I need not specify that what do I need to have as a placeholder for my BigPipes, and it automatically identifies. But it won't actually affect the page load time. If you see the page load time, it's actually not affecting that much. The thing that we are want to see here is the perceived performance by the user. So that's all from my end. Any question and answers? Any questions from the crowd?
Yes.
Sorry? Do I need to come? Sorry.
How can you leverage a custom block? For instance, you have a custom block which does an API call. How do you tell the block that it has to use BigPipe?
So the one I'm using right now in my case is a dynamic block, which fetches all the Twitter feeds that we provide in a configuration. So what I really do is provide a hash placeholder in my render API. So let me show you how I use that. So that's my that's the structure of the Drupal 8. So for the people who are really new to Drupal 8, that's the structure for the Drupal 8 module. So I have a block here. And what I really need to do here is, that's a block, and I provide a path to the lazy builder, and I just need to add a create placeholder true. So that's what distinguished between my dynamic content for the placeholder. And that was the snapshot that I used for the placeholder, wherein you can see that this dynamic block has been identified by the BigPipe. This is the answer to your question. Thank you. Any more?
Yep.
Yeah.
Why wouldn't you turn on BigPipe?
Why wouldn't I turn on BigPipe?
Yeah, so if BigPipe is great, under what circumstances would you not want it?
So there are the cases wherein you just don't feel the need that you have a really dynamic page. Like, there can be cases where user can have a page to see the dynamic content after 5 seconds. You can have the maximum time page cache as 5 seconds rather than enabling the whole BigPipe module.
But is BigPipe not better?
BigPipe is better, but why to have a whole module and creating the placeholder when we just can quote in the render API as a max age? Because anyhow, BigPipe is using the same render API, correct? So if we are just want to have the, when we have a low significance of the dynamic content there, we can just have the max cache age as just 5 seconds or 6 seconds, rather than having the big pipe to work through all the same render API and create another thing, so, and another render API.
And a follow-up question then, does it play nicely with Nginx and Varnish?
I haven't tried it yet with Nginx and Varnish. Thank you. Any more questions?